mind a bit. Right back to the beginning. That's it, magic. A picture paints a thousand words, as they say. Okay, but what paints the picture? When your work of art is a television program, the palette of special effects at your disposal these days is extremely colorful. And in this program, we're going to take you behind the scenes and let you into a few little secrets. We're going to show you a little of how the video magic that you take for granted is actually conjured up. So let's start at the beginning with our opening title sequence and find out how they would... Wait a minute. What's going on here? Oh, I need a psychiatrist. Cue Anthony Clare!
Okay, Kenny, don't lose your head. To make those animated QED titles, take one film camera, rotate it through 90 degrees, and connect it to a computer. Now, hang the film camera on a hoist that can raise and lower it under the control of the same computer. Underneath the camera, mount a table on which you're going to spread your artwork.
Doesn't look much like artwork to me.
Hang on. Put a motor underneath so the computer can rotate the table or move it backwards and forwards, and you have a computerized rostrum camera. This computer's loosening up on a past exercise before beginning the job of making our QED titles. The film the camera produces as a result of all these gyrations will look like this. On with our QED artwork.
I could have drawn that.
Cover the artwork up with black painted plastic so the camera can't see it, and then it's a case of scraping off the black paint, bit by bit, to reveal the QED logo, tiny section by tiny section. And each time you've scraped to reveal another section, you expose a bit of film. While you're about it, rotate the table a bit between scrapes and film a bit more. That way, you animate all the pink parts in the middle of the letters QED. What about the blue parts? Just rewind the film and the camera right back to the beginning, replace the pink filter by a blue one, put on new artwork for the outside of the letters, reshoot the film, and a touch of electronic magic lets us see the results in advance. By now you can guess how the letters disappear again.
Those QED titles were made 3 whole years ago, but now film has to compete with a whole galaxy of electronic boxes of tricks that can produce all the movements and effects and color and paint them straight onto video, like this.
This little illusion materialized from a box of tricks that specializes in assembling, flying, and breaking up TV images. The next bounces these images all over the screen. And finally, there's a machine that can produce abstract effects, each machine painting straight onto television. What if we let them loose on a sequence to introduce the program you're watching now, the Magic Picture Show? The first thing you find is the cleverest of black boxes is helpless without a graphic designer to turn the producer's original concept into something the video effects supervisor can handle with his electronic machines.
Well, if you're calling it the Magic Picture Show, we need something that looks like a picture and magic happens in it.
Yeah, that's the end of the title sequence, and the rest of the show could happen in the magic picture, but somehow we need to lead up to the magic picture itself.
Well, we could paint it using an electronic paint box.
Takes too long.
Well, we edit it.
Yes, but what is a picture? A picture is something you can see. You need light to see. Light comes from the sun. I could be finishing off the sun inside the magic picture, and the title sequence could follow from that.
Bright idea, but I bet he doesn't know what he's started. First, we shoot Kenny with the magic picture. The background isn't really there. It's a close-up of the magic picture itself, put there by electronic overlay. Next, we spend quite some time just shooting Kenny coming out through a door.
This will be it for sure. Sequence G, take two.
Hello, and welcome to the Magic Picture Show. It's the last time I'm doing that.
Both scenes, the door scene and the magic picture scene, are recorded onto separate videotapes. The following day, here's the scene in the video effects workshop. The video effects supervisor has at his disposal a galaxy of knobs, buttons, and faders, controlling enough computerized wizardry to turn anything the producer can visualize into television pictures, given the right props. Over to one side of the workshop are a few stars and a picture of the Earth from space. A model maker working for the visual effects department positions his piece of Perspex sculpture, important this, it plays a key role in the coming sequence, oh, and a hole in a piece of black card for a light to shine through to represent the sun. Over in a corner, the graphic designer standing by with an electronic paint box to draw the outline of an optic nerve. All we need now is a slide of a retina mixed with the magic picture itself, and we've half a day's work ahead of us to produce the next 30 seconds. All ready? Go! Kenny's right, of course. Every artist needs sunlight to see what he's painting. Light comes from that neighboring star we call the sun, and it's carried to us by photons. Photons can take 10 million years to battle their way out of the interior of the sun to its surface, and only 8.5 minutes to streak off across space at the speed of light to reach the Earth. When we see anything illuminated, photons are absorbed by the subject and re-emitted into our eyes, carrying information about the view with them. The lens of the eye casts an image of that view on the retina. The retina turns photons into pulses of electricity. These carry coded information about that picture to the brain. Finally, the brain decodes all these fragments of information and our minds get the message.
Hello, and welcome to the Magic Picture Show!
Magic indeed. But then we're looking at a world that's been pretty used to magic. The motion picture business hadn't been going 5 minutes before directors started using tricks. One of the first was to film a bit, stop the camera, take something away, and start the camera again to make things disappear, and come back. Amazing how effective these ancient films can be. It's only when you slow them down that you begin to see how the tricks were done. Here comes one place where they stopped the film. Now. And here it started again. Peep behind the scenes at any early film studio and you'd find directors reveling in visual trickery. In fact, the antics the visual effects department got up to were often more entertaining than the film itself. At this stage, everything appeared in what the film trade calls a wide shot. Just like the theatre, you saw everything at once, all the time. If you wanted a change of scene, you signalled it well in advance. Easy to follow, but rather restricting if you've got a real-life story to tell. What if you just want someone to walk from one room to another? Okay, you could do it like this. The director was so enchanted with his new trick, just tracking the camera through a hole in the wall, literally, you can even see the plumbing leading up to the taps, that he used the trick again and again. But soon, the room-to-room maneuver was done in a more sophisticated fashion. Bedroom A, corridor, bedroom B. They simply cut between locations. and the cut was quickly taken for granted because it's what our eyes do naturally. When we look from one side to another, our eyelids close. They cut in between. And it's very natural that they should. Otherwise, we'd be doing what the film world calls whip pans all the time, and our brains would get overloaded with the moving scene and we'd feel dizzy. So the cut is natural. But you still have to get it right. If people exit right, you expect them to come back in left. Otherwise, you wonder where they've been. Put the camera the wrong side of them in the corridor, and the result's quite upsetting. Skillfully set up, cuts can be piled in thick and fast. It's drinks time. It's coffee time. It's the brown one. Slosh it down one. Canteen coffee.
Thanks. I needed that.
Now, that brief commercial contained a lot of cuts. Let's run it again, and I'll count them as they go through. One, two,
it's coffee time.
Three, four, five, six, seven, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22,
it's
23,
slosh it down one, canteen coffee,
24, cut. And commercials only get away with it because the cut is so natural. The same applies to the zoom. Now, our eyes don't zoom, but the zoom's obviously a parallel to paying close attention to something.
And the mix denoted the passage of time, almost like dozing off and waking up somewhere else.
Right. And because these tricks of the film trade parallel what we do with our eyes, we accept them as natural. The problem came when engineers discovered you don't have to paint TV pictures in the time-honored way, tracing them out from top to bottom as a series of lines. It may have been technically convenient for television, but not all media treat pictures this way. Newspaper pictures, for example, are made up of bits, not lines. Small bits, and you get a light patch printed. Bigger bits, and it's darker. Bits nowadays imply computers. Couldn't we use computers to deal with TV pictures in roughly the same way as newspapers? Then the computer could rearrange the bits of the picture and make it do all kinds of gymnastic exercises. Video effects sequences like these are very big business. America, Japan, and England are all vying with each other to manufacture machines that produce more and more complex effects. This sequence celebrates a machine made by a British company. And here comes another, made by an American firm.
Hello.
We're going to send you up the pole and round the bend now as we bounce your eyeballs all over your living room with the aid of this little box of tricks here, a computerized doodah that sends your picture potty. And here we go. For instance, if you twist the knob round here like that, you can go that way in any direction at any speed, or the opposite direction like that. You can flip it that way, flip it that way, or flip it that way, and twist and turn and generally make an absolute nuisance of ourselves. Whee! Of course, you can get it back to normal just by going coink and do something really complicated like waddle the picture away or make it do really sexy things by pressing recall effect. One, two, where's three gone? Oh, there it is. Run. Watch this, you'll like this. Well, it's been fun, folks. See you later. Bye. Later on that day, hello again.
Careful, Ken. Don't mess the computer around. It'll... Oh, well. Spectacular, but unlike the cut and the zoom and the mix, no longer natural. If you still want the art that conceals art, how do you conceal new effects like these?
Some of us don't even try. For instance, I'm sitting here talking to you, and suddenly I'm in a little box, flying all over the screen like this. And with the push of another button, I'm upside down. And then I'm stretched out of shape, put back in a box, and sent tumbling into infinity and back again. And then over and over until... Oh, God. I gotta get out of here.
Oh, somebody help me. I'm up here.
Coming up in the next hour on Breakfast Time, when is a Cornish pasty a Cornish pasty? Glyn Christian puts one in the oven.
Comedy apart, there are many areas of television where different pictures in different boxes make a useful display device. And the ability to display two or more moving images at once can solve a journalistic nightmare. How do you cope with a race when you keep wanting to opt out to interview a competitor? Like this.
15,000 people are going to ride down to Brighton and enjoy themselves. And, of course, this isn't a new idea. The London Brighton Ride has seen the whole of the history of the bicycle's development.
And you're going along the road, car comes up behind, beep, beep, you know, all the whole scene, fists shaking out the window and stuff. I mean, if you were on a horse, they'd stop and they'd all wave, you know. Well, if you were a milkman with a milk float travelling at half the speed of a bike, they'd be polite and wait, you know. I think it's something to do with this image of the bicycle as someone who can't afford the car.
And here's another multiple image that can only be described as natural if you're a particularly heavy drinker.
10,000 cuddly cans. Will your license be run to this?
No. But anyway, take one stick, paint it with the reflecting paint they use on motorway signs, shine a strong light on it from the camera, add electronic feedback, and you can do this. Or Wayne Sleep can do this.
Take the advice of an old figure. Take to the stage and you'll make a million. Let them boogie or rock, just as long as you know. A chip off the block of an old vaudevillian.
Okay, it's not. From electronic fantasy to reality. Or is it reality? Use an electronic paint box to carve an aeroplane out of a picture that shows it parked safely on the runway. And you can use the computer power of the paint box to place the aeroplane against any desired background. A few finishing touches, and it's obvious. that we can no longer believe the evidence of our own senses now that computer graphics has arrived. This kind of experience is soon going to be made available to the public, but we'll be given different pictures to look at and react to. This is a test bed for the most exciting computerized trip ever, a tour of the universe. But even the down-to-earth rehearsals using roller coasters and the like are thrilling enough for some.
Ladies and gentlemen, would you excuse me while I have a word with my producer? You bastard!
But why use a simulator to produce movement when you can move yourself? In the pipeline is some amazing research involving artificial intelligence, computer-generated images, and a helmet that delivers stereo TV pictures to each eye. The computer will sense your movements and move the TV pictures accordingly. You will be right inside the world of the computerized video game. Oh, well done, Kenny. Watch out. And if that's a bit too exciting, there are gentler pastimes. As games like this catch on and costs come down, every holiday, every pastime, every experience there ever was will be available to us just by slotting in the right floppy disk. Far from trying to make our video effects mimic reality, we may actually come to prefer the magic pictures of our world as seen through the eye of the computer.
QED next week is at the slightly later time of 9:35 and looks at the microscopic world of conflict between insects and plants.